that feeling like you're dancing with the Reaper, you're dancing with the devil, and you won. Like you survived. You dance with the ugliest one and you survived.
I stepped on fucking probably on a 17 IEDs that didn't go off. Right? Like there's a horseshoe somewhere so far up my prostate that I have no idea how I'm sitting here in front of you.
I'm from Long Island, New York. That's where I grew up. There was a lot of like patriotism, you know, and just all around like belief in the military and, you know, firemen, policemen after 9/11.
Like many high schoolers coming out of Southern Oregon, I just didn't know I'd have a plan. I had some military influence. You know, my grandfather was someone I really respected. He's a real father figure and a role model for me growing up.
I'm from a city called Taunton, Massachusetts. I was about 16 years old when I started like moving out of my parents' house because those guys are a piece of shit. I joined, you know, to get the fuck out of that place. My aunt would always explain to me when I told her I joined the Marines, she's like, oh wow, like, you know, like that kind of makes sense. And I'm like, why? And she's like, oh, well, you know, your stepdad, Mark, treated you like you were in boot camp.
My parents are both born in Mexico. They came over to this country about 30 years ago, 30 plus years ago.
My stepdad, I remember, was like, I want you to be like that guy in Starship Troopers, you know, like the intel guy. I want you to do intelligence. I'm like, cool, fuck you, infantry.
I wanted to go over there and I wanted to see it firsthand. I knew the risks, I knew the consequences, because like I had lost friends already before I was even in. So I signed up, chose the infantry.
I was just kind of like a shit little kid, you know, where it's like I want to fight. And I always told myself I have to be infantry, like something you have to do, I feel like.
Me, I want to say thank you to my mom for sending me these goddamn peaches. I don't know if you can see them, but...
I really wanted to push myself and see where the boundaries of what I can achieve is. I thought the infantry were perfect for that. You know, I'm literally signing up to go into combat.
Once I got in, it was just like, one day after the other, and then slowly but surely it was like, okay, we're going to fucking Afghanistan.
Immediately getting off the C-17, they're like, all right, move over, and they just started putting coffins with like American flag draped on them on there.
It's like, hey, does anyone fucking want to be a dog handler or whatever? You know, real offhandedly. So I go through the program, I get paired up with a German Shepherd, his name's Alex.
We knew it was going to be pretty kinetic. Turns out it was.
The goings-on of like the entire time it happened was there.
They hadn't pushed out of their wire over 500 meters because it was that kinetic.
I remember the first time I got shot at.
20 minutes in this hike.
One of the team leaders in my squad.
ANA guy just explodes.
Blew up in front of me.
It was my first month in country.
He stepped on a pressure plate IED.
This is my first time outside the wire.
We just hear like RPK, fucking AK open up on our left side.
We were hunkering down.
I seen the smoke go up like 15 meters in the sky and he just collapsed.
Immediately, explode, complex ambush.
Lay myself down.
Then it started picking up a bit.
Alex like wanders over to me, licking me in the face.
Oh no, like fucking, like what did I do?
Gravel's getting kicked up and whatever.
I pushed to right behind this little berm.
Between us and all that gunfire, fucking just that little gravel pit right there.
I froze, I choked up, and the men inside the house put tourniquets on them.
For like, I couldn't return fire that first gunfight because it was heavy.
One of the senior Marines, you know, came in right next to me.
All right, this is setting the tone, like.
Looked over at me, he's like, what are you smiling about?
Buckle up, you know.
Was combat fun for you? Were there fun elements?
Yeah.
To hear like a sound I've never heard before.
Every sensor in your body is going off.
The adrenaline.
The adrenaline going.
It's the best adrenaline rush you can hope for.
Every time we shot back at Petrobius Priest, it was like a fucking party.
Just like hit fire on the 240s, like this is great.
Mad until it fucking stops.
Especially after patrolling and like not getting combat for a while, you're like, thank fucking God, there's a reason we're out here.
It's a lot of fun, you know, right up until somebody gets hurt.
I remember it was like everything we wanted as infantry guys. It was like everything you wanted as a boot, as a junior Marine. You wanted to see combat. That's like why we enlisted into the infantry. And it's just one of those things that you wish for it so badly that when it happens, it's not exactly like what you thought it would be. And it gets real, real quick.
Somebody grabbed me and it was like, fucking Lawler's dead. You know, he died. I didn't know how to take it in that moment because I just saw him. You know, I just talked to him. I just sat there.
Great individuals, wrong place, wrong time, like, bam, kids will never meet them. And I was just some 19-year-old dude from fucking some trailer park in Massachusetts. The way that I coped with it is like, you know, the universe is random because, like, there's no way that I deserved more than those guys did. A lot of people end up like going to like, you know, being like, oh, well, you know, God has a plan. And I'm like, well, I'm not religious. And that guy was. And that guy like has no head now. So like, how do you justify any of that? To get on like a religious soapbox, like if there is a God, like it doesn't care.
At that point of the deployment, I mean, you compartmentalize it, you push it down, you keep going on with your day. Cause you know in the back of your head, you're like, well, their parents are getting notified. You still got to go on patrol later. Still got to, you know, man post. Like, now we got one less person.
Damn, that's my buddy. Damn, that's so-and-so. Damn, that's this person. And it literally became this thing of better them than me. And that's a shitty thing to say, but we really got to that point.
Being angry and pissed off and then joking and smoking with dudes and like having fun and then, you know, having loss happen to you and fucking having dudes get shot. And it was interesting just having that roller coaster effect and then having it all kind of fucking stop when I come back.
It was a big time disconnect. I mean, my parents and my girlfriend at the time picked me up from 29 Palms, and I just knew that nothing would ever be the same. I remember, I think my dad asked me a couple questions about like what had happened over there, and I couldn't talk. My mom just told him like, we're not gonna talk about that. I never had a chance to debrief from the war. I never had a chance to decompose all the shit that had happened. Up until when I got out, I realized like, what the fuck, you know? Something's not cool. Something's not there. Like, the family's love, you know? Just celebrating my birthday and something inside of me couldn't resonate with it. I couldn't accept it. I felt like I didn't deserve it. I thought that love and compassion was something like soft. I thought that we couldn't feel those emotions and that we didn't really rate them. That because of some of the heinous shit that we'd done and seen, that we weren't allowed to feel those feelings anymore. And I was totally wrong. I literally had to leave. I had to leave my family. It's very real. And it's a physiological, chemical imbalance that happens in your brain, your operating system up here. And when it happens, it can be anything. They call them triggers, call them whatever the hell you want. It could be a color, it could be a smell, it could be a sound, it could be a look, it could be anything. It could be literally anything. For me, on the morning of March 7th, I was on my way to school, and my squad that I deployed with on my second deployment, we used to always play this song called Bad Company by Five Finger Death Punch. And subconsciously, I never realized it, but I'm playing it on my way to school. And as I'm playing it, I'm just like rocking out, just feeling the vibe. And that's what we used to do before we would head out, like into a mission or into a patrol, just to get pumped up, get the blood flowing. And as I'm riding in my car, getting to school, I'm just ready to go, get into class, and I get into class. It's my business law class at Cal State Long Beach. And out of nowhere, this feeling of rage, of aggravation, of just anger, just becomes so overwhelming where I'm in class and I'm like looking at my teacher. My teacher's an awesome lady. She's just super professor, just really cool lady. She's a lawyer. She has no reason to be judged or to be felt like the way that I was feeling towards her. And I was so angry. She was just doing her job, and I just felt like fuck you, lady. Like, shut the hell up. Like if I could, I would hurt her. Terrible to say that, but that's exactly how I felt. And it became so overwhelming to the point where I'm literally sitting in class at university and I'm like so angry. And I start to cry in there. Like, there's tears coming out of my eyes. I'm a grown ass man, and it's like I'm sitting there so angry for no reason. And I didn't realize it, but that was the anniversary date to my second deployment. It was a fifth year anniversary. And I still have a lot of anger towards the government, towards people that did us foul, towards people that really we had no closure with, that I still want to speak to. I still have this anger, this rage that's stuck in my body somewhere, and it's manifested itself in other areas.
A few devil dogs on post early in the morning.
And if you would have looked at my life from the outside, it looked good. Like, he's going to school, he has a nice car, he has nice clothes, he's doing his thing, he's making money. But internally, I was hurting. I was hurting bad. The best analogy that I could give you is, it's like if you're in a well that's super deep and you're down there and you're just treading water trying to survive, but eventually you're gonna get fatigued enough and tap out. And that's where I was. And unfortunately, I had to have a situation where one of my buddies, he was a machine gunner attached to our squad, his name was Cameron Favela. He committed suicide April 16th of 2016. In my eyes, he was an alpha. He was an alpha, he was a machine gunner, he was a hard charger. He was everything that you could think of as a warrior. He was the embodiment of what a Marine machine gunner should be. And when he committed suicide, it was an eye-opener, like, yo, there's something wrong. There's a malfunction that we're having as infantry combat veterans, and I need to address it. I need to talk to somebody about this. I remember the day he committed suicide, I called the VA, I called the local vet center, and I told them, like, hey, you know what? I need to talk to somebody.
One of my dad's good friends was a fireman during 9/11. I always looked up to him. I worked with him for a little bit doing sprinkler installation while I was still going to community college for the Marine Corps. And he went through some stuff after 9/11. And so, like, I kind of took my cue from him on processing. And right before I left, he sat me down and he said, you go over there, you do what you need to do, and then you come home. And as you're getting ready to get back on that plane and come home, you empty your pockets and you leave that shit over there. I obviously didn't leave all of it over there. You know, some of it still sticks with you.
Marine driving a Mustang, something you don't see every day.
So the transition is weird anyway, because for 7 straight months, you're carrying a rifle and you're responsible for that weapon. And there are still moments like during the post-deployment leave, where you'll wake up and you're like, oh shit, like, where's my rifle? Because if you lose your rifle, you're screwed. So, like, that's weird that you're not carrying, you know, especially in New York, you can't carry anything. So I think I had already felt uncomfortable because of that, and then like, because everything was still so fresh. I can't stand crowds anymore. Like, being packed into like a crowded bar, I hate it. It's one of the reasons I left New York. Like, I like open spaces, and I like, you know, I like to be able to move around. So like, you decide that like you're getting out, and you're like, well, I'm gonna be a civilian again. Like, I'm gonna be around all these people, and like, how do I transition correctly? Like, what am I gonna do? What's life gonna be like? Because this is all I've known for the last 4 years, you know, and now I'm going back to this world where I really don't feel like I fit in. So.
You know what that means. I'm not doing that shit again.
Emotional lows. I'm not sure I can describe it. It's, I think I've pushed it too far down. I can't really remember what that felt like. I've had fucking times where like I've been doing or watching something, all of a sudden I get like real emotional because I guess it reminds me of something and I can't even like remember what it is that it's reminding me of, but I'm like, why am I so sad right now? Like watching this like commercial or something, you know? Well, why is this affecting me? And I think that might be what it is, but I don't know. And, you know, and then, you know, then you push it back down and you go home with your day. Some of the guys that I serve with have committed suicide. I guess like I almost don't fault the person because like if they got to that place that it was bad enough, like, and that's what they felt they had to do, and like, and that's fine, I guess. You know, it's your life. If you wanna end it, then I guess you should be able to. For selfish reasons, I think it's selfish because like you're hurting everybody else. Yeah, you got to take personal accountability. You know, if you start to go down that rabbit hole, you know, and you start to feel those bad feelings, you know, or think those bad thoughts, you got to reach out. Permanent solution to a temporary problem.
Yeah, so I came back from that deployment and felt older. I felt kind of out of it, you know? It's like something fucking devastating happened and I don't know what's going, I don't know how to go through it. There's so many moments where like I sat and I cried in fucking Alex's kennel because I just, it was a lot, you know? It was just fucking a lot going on in my mind. And Alex would fucking just sit with me and like cuddle and fucking, it was nice, right? And that was something that I had that I took advantage of because he was there for me. And I didn't have that. Like once Alex went away, I didn't have that. And I struggled with anger and hypervigilance and night terrors and nightmares and all this shit after. And it got worse once I got out too. I didn't think anyone could relate to it, right? Average human being or like average person, average American, like I don't feel comfortable talking about this shit. Because they would look at me like a foreign object. I was kind of an angry kid growing up, you know? And in the infantry, you're trained to take that anger and do something with it, right? To give it direction. When I got out, like I didn't have any direction for it anymore. Like that was it. You know, there's no place for anger in the way that is used in the infantry or like at that capacity in life. It just sucks to like, you know, be going through your day and then all of a sudden you're fucking angry for some reason and you don't exactly know why. And you know, then you're starting to think about it and like, oh shit, it's fighting season. Yep, that's why. That's why I'm fucking angry. All that stuff just started compounding and getting worse and worse, and my hypervigilance would get worse and my anger issues would get worse, and I didn't have a great outlet for it, you know. And I went to therapy and therapy didn't work.
Oh, that guy reads
light reading.
That guy reads stoicism.
Bring that up.
That's why I found out about the dog program and got into that, because it gave me an aspect of myself that I was sorely missing, which was a dog at my side. I found that my aggressive tendencies have gone down a lot just from having her around and just being able to take care of her. This is going to be a part of my life from now on. You know, how do I make it healthy? How do I reduce the effects? You know, how do I move forward? And it's something like a lot of folks don't do. You know, a lot of infantry cats fucking, they kill themselves because they can't answer those questions. And that's real rough. You know, I've had a couple people commit suicide on me. Just because they were isolated and didn't feel like they could handle it.
I want to do actors in blacks and just not make it about, make it about the acting rather than about the costumes and like the spectacle,
right.
But more about the actors like being kind of intense, yeah. and getting these emotions across.
I definitely couldn't emote as much as I could beforehand, you know, and I knew I came off cold. Eventually, like, you know, I could joke around and, like, you know, be fun, but, like, I don't know, like, me expressing, like, my feelings or, like, frustrations, like, I couldn't do it. Like, I remember I was, like, seeing this girl, and, like, one time, I don't know, I was just, like, being bothered by her just, like, being next to me, like, in fucking bed, so I was like, yeah, fuck it, I'll sleep in the bathtub, and I remember her, like, freaking out, and I was like, no, like, this is normal, like, this is a fucking normal thing, like, body shaped. I'm in here. The tile's cool. Like, you know.
I bought it out of Cabela's, I think.
There's stages of, like, grief, you know. Like, because especially, like, during deployment, you don't have the chance to do that. You know, because you're, like, if you start, you know, breaking down, they're like, oh, cool. Like, you know, like, I get, I know you have, like, some time that you have to, like, take by yourself, but, like, you know, fuck it. Gear up in 4 hours, we have patrol. Like, you know, the machine doesn't stop moving. I watched a person die, like, extremely horribly, and, like, let me just fucking download that, man. I went through, like, you know, like, I had a moment, like, it was hard to get used to, like, not being, like, fucking in a panicked rage all the time. I was like, hey, man, like, you know, shit's going on, like, you know, I am not fucking, like, well-balanced right now. I need to talk to someone. You know, nothing you say with her, like, will be, like, you know, used against you or anything like that. I'm like, sweet. So, like, you know, I did that, and I just, like, was telling her, like, what was going on, like, how, like, you know, it was just, you know, hard for me to sleep, and, like, I was having panic attacks once in a while, and, you know, talking through that helped. But what ended up happening was this guy that ended up becoming the fucking section leader, he was like, oh, well, you know, I noticed that you went to the things, like, what happens if that happens in combat? So he ended up taking my fucking team leader position away from me and gave it to someone else. Then after that, I fucking internalized everything. I don't think I'll ever seek another, like, professional source anymore, because, like, now I know that that can be fucking held over you, so I'll just vent to my friends.
The girl that I broke things off with, you just matched on Bumble.
It worked out for me for a while, you know? And then, you know, once in a while, like I said, I'd get fucking drunk and I'd just start crying on someone's shoulder. Because, like, I couldn't, you know, if I wasn't allowed to let it all out at once, I'll just, like, let it out in little spurts that I couldn't control, apparently, you know?
I started off with a horticulture major, but then found out that it was just a bunch of hippies trying to smoke weed and, like, with zero work ethic. So I ended up switching over to,
I know that in, like, you know, in the past, you know, my most recent relationship, it's just like, hey, you don't communicate. I'm like, yeah, because, you know, what I'm thinking is none of your fucking business. But, so, like, you know, like, there's definitely communication problems, and I've gotten that, I've heard that feedback from a lot of grunts, Army and Marines, like, just being like, you know, we're just bad communicators, because, like, our feelings are our own, and they're inconsequential to you, and, like, there's nothing you can do about them, so why even unload the burden, you know? I don't know.
You've got a girlfriend right now, right?
Not anymore. Yeah, communication issues, right? How do you, like, cope with everything seems mundane? You know, because, like, my job, like, I was dealing with rocket launchers and explosives, you know? I just got out of a midterm reading about fucking, like, a novel about, like, fucking feminist bullshit now, and I'm just like, this is, like, really, like, these are my concerns now? Like, this is... Like, it's, you know, like, it's a shit consolation prize. I get why fucking, you know, so many vets commit suicide. It's because, like, one day they're just like, fuck this, like, you know. But it's hard, man, like, when you just, like, you know, up and quit. Especially on people that depend on you, you know. It's like, some of my friends that, like, you know, committed suicide, like, they were married and had kids. Like, yeah, cool, man, like, you made the decision for yourself, like, but what about them?
I went in there, like, super on defense, ready to, super tense. It was, like, a couple of days after we had buried my buddy in Santa Barbara. And I remember he asked me, like, when was the last time that you were happy? And I told him, you know what, I'm not happy, and I haven't been happy for a very long time. And he told me, put these headphones on and just listen. Don't do anything, close your eyes, just listen. And it was a 60-second meditation. It was 1 minute. And I remember doing it, and when I got out of that minute, I felt like half an hour had gone by. I got this sense of peace of mind that I had never experienced before. And I was freaking out. I was like, what the fuck was that? What was that? Like, what did you just do? He told me, that's meditation. I realized that it helped, and that was like the first sign of like peace of mind. And it was amazing, and I meditate every day now. I try to, at least.
Feel how your left foot feels on the inside. Scan it up to your ankles. How does your ankle feel? Scan up to the...
I found, you know, looking into Muay Thai and starting to practice it, and getting pretty competent with that martial art, is that it gave me an outlet to focus that anger. You know, and obviously, like, lifting weights is the same idea. You're taking aggressiveness, you're taking anger, and you're giving it direction. You know, you're lifting weights, you're improving yourself. I think it's a really important aspect of us that we kind of, either we let go, you know, which is fine. I think that's totally cool if a person can just let that shit go. But for me, I can't, so I gotta do something with it, right?
I was lucky that I had a good friend like Anthony, you know, who got out, called me up, said, hey, I'm gonna move to Oregon, you should come with me. And I was like, absolutely, I'll move cross country with him. And I think being able to stay with somebody that you deployed with, and like that you know, everything about, like, that you, and you guys can talk about anything together, I think that more than anything helped me to, you know, make sure that I was moving forward and not staying stuck in the same place, you know, just. So I think that's what happens to a lot of guys, is it's, they get caught in a rut, and, you know, they start digging down instead of digging out.
I think it absolutely helps, like, not feeling special, because, like, you know, it takes a lot of, like, a lot of the pressure off of, like, your experiences, you know, for good or for bad, but. I think that, like, it definitely lightens the load when you realize that, like, oh yeah, shit, I'm not the only one carrying it.
A lot of vets, in my experience anyways, like, they want to invest back in the country, and I kind of want to do that. Plus, like,
I tried, like, you know, making friends in school, and it's just, like, it's not even the age gap, it's just, like, there's just a mentality gap and, like, a maturity gap, I think. I tried, you know, and I tried, like, to just be like, oh, like, you know, everyone's an adult here, but, like, it didn't feel that way. I always try to explain being, like, combat vet more specifically as being, like, an exchange, like a international student here. It's like, yeah, like, I might be American, but, like, we are not of the same culture. Some shit that I do will be fucking abhorrent to you, and some shit that you do is gonna make me fucking sick. And it's weird, like, you have to, like, it's a weird feeling to have to cross cultural boundaries inside your own nation.
Since I've been going to, like, college, I've been called fucking an elitist. I've been called fucking assertive and aggressive, and all of these things by folks who've never been in my shoes, who've never seen what I've seen and done what I've done. And it's interesting to, like, process all that in my mind and think, you know, like, they don't understand, or they, and that's okay. Like, it's okay they don't understand. That's kind of the point, right? That we went and we fought so that they didn't have to.
You're either Chris Kyle or you're Timothy McVeigh.
Yeah.
You know, like, fucking, and everyone's just waiting to find out who you are. Or they just assume one way or the other. I think that raising awareness for how, like, for the effects of, not like what the effects of war do to people, it's the effect of like coming back to society and what society does for people that have done things for them.
Have perspective on why we have all this shit around us. Like, understand where all this affluence comes from. You know, it comes from fucking dying. It comes from, you know, talk to a Gold Star family. Show your appreciation to a fucking Gold Star family. That's important, man.
Again, like, you know, people like see me and I'm like, oh yeah, I was in the Marines. I'm like, oh cool, like you were in the Army? I'm like, no, like, you don't even understand like what branches there are. Like, we are the world power right now. Like, how do you not understand how we've done that?
Memorial Day is coming up soon. How many Americans are gonna go to a vigil and pay respects? How many Americans are just gonna take the day off and not give a fucking shit about all of the men and women who have died, allowing them what they have that day? That's where it comes from, man.
Memorial Day, to me, as far as a history, a family tradition, I spent my young years at many cemeteries planting many flags for many veterans.
I think on those days, what's interesting is, because I think about them, but then I also, like, I think about their families, you know, because a lot of those guys, you know, had kids or had parents, and like you think about like what they're going through on that day, because that never gets easier when you lose a family member.
We should take pride in being Americans and having what we have in this moment, and obviously always try to better ourselves and make things more equal as possible, and try to strive for the values of like an American.
It gives me more drive, which has been difficult because I know what I don't want to do, and what I do want to do is difficult. I definitely was never a great student, so wanting to go into the medical field like has been rough, and I have had to grind to do it. But because I know I only have a short amount of time and I know what I want to do with that amount of time, like that makes it pretty nice.
I got introduced to this meditation group. The organization is called Project Welcome Home Troops, and essentially what they do is they go all around the country and they teach veterans how to do this practice called the power breath. It helps you live in the moment, it helps you become fully present. My goal is to help veterans that are going through, whether it be the same struggle or similar struggle.
I'm a fucking kid from a backwoods town in Oregon. When I joined the infantry, I got to meet people from all across this country who walked all different sorts of life. I got exposed to so much more than just my little podunk town, right? And that was important. Tons of intersectionality, tons.
I don't want to look back and be like, what did I do? How did I help? Who did I influence? You know, like, what's my legacy?
This is a story about our good buddy Cole, nicest guy I know. He's a fucking sweetheart, and he got the Silver Star.
Although there was a lot of loss in there, there's a lot of identity built and a lot of self-respect kind of developed over time. It was an interesting experience, man. And it's just one of those things where it influences me forever forward.
It comes from understanding what the darkness feels like. It comes from understanding what it feels like to play the victim role. It comes from understanding what it feels like to go through it and feel like you're the only one going into isolation. And really what it is, it's my buddy. It's my buddy, Cameron Favela. I know that he's watching. I know that he's watching. And I feel like I have a mission to help out as many veterans, whether you're a combat veteran or just a regular dude that's going through it, that you're going through that darkness. Because I came to this conclusion that it's not only veterans, it's everyone. That's why America is at an all-time opioid addiction. That's why America has had a 30-year suicide high rate, because we're not comfortable in our own skin. And I realized this that there's this conversation that we're not having as men because we think you're weak if you speak about certain things that you're going through. There's absolutely nothing weak about a reality that you're going through. And the quicker that you're able to address it and not play the victim card, but instead shift it into victor, that's what I'm doing. I do it because of my buddy that committed suicide. I do it because I know there's other individuals that probably will never speak on it, but they're going through it too. And instead of being afraid and this little soft person that's like, hey, like if I reach out for help, what are my buddies gonna say? Fuck what your buddy said. Like no one gives a fuck about like what anyone's gotta say. The fact is that you're going through some shit, and if you need to address it, you need to address it as a man. And I think that speaks volumes about a man rather than you trying to act and show this alpha, which is not true. You know, like it's just a reality. You're not supposed to play the victim. That's not cool either. But get into this mode where you go on offense and you fight back against those demons. You tell them you're not gonna fucking own me anymore. I'm fucking sick and tired of being sick and tired, and I'm not gonna let this shit defeat me. I think by addressing your vulnerabilities, it speaks volumes, and that's the strength that you have to convert those vulnerabilities into your strengths and own them, like fully own them. Be like, hey, I'm weak in this place, but I'm not gonna stay there. I'm not gonna stay weak in that place. I'm gonna grow it, I'm gonna get stronger, and it's gonna get to the point where I literally cannot be defeated by anything.
Tired of fighting all over this town. Broken every bone in my right hand. Cut your face with an old beacon. Time is such a rumor mill. Shut your light upon me.